are continuing our sermon series, Reclaiming the Family. Last week, Pastor Susan spoke about families and God's commandment that we honor our fathers and mothers so that our days are long in the land that He gives to us. Now, whether our parents were loving or not, whether they were present in our lives or not, whether they were honorable or not, our relationships with our parents and our families influence us for the rest of our lives. Parenting has got to be the toughest job in the world. There is no other job that requires you to work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, never having a day off from that moment you become a parent until the day that you leave this earth. There is no salary, no retirement, and you never get a day of vacation. You are responsible for keeping your children alive, for teaching them how to walk and talk, to care for themselves, teach them manners and boundaries, right from wrong, self-discipline, how to function in the world, how to become independent, how to be in relationship with others, and most importantly, how to be in relationship with their Creator God and with their Savior, Jesus Christ. God knew what a tough job parenting was going to be. That's why He created families, moms and dads, to share in the work and responsibility of parenting. But that is not all. God also knew that mothers and fathers were going to need help. So He created extended families, grandparents, aunts and uncles, who also helped to raise, guide, teach, and nurture His children. This morning, our focus is on grandparents and the role that they play within the family. There are many places in Scripture where God specifically addresses grandparents, and we will look at some of those. As we do, I encourage you to include, along with biological grandparents, others who fill that role in the lives of children. Step-grandparents, aunts, uncles, great-aunts and great-uncles, godparents, and all of the senior saints whom God puts in our lives to care for us, to teach us, to love us, and to be role models for us. And that includes just about everyone. All of us have grandparents. Not all of us are grandparents, but God calls all of us to be responsible in helping to train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. That's from Proverbs 22:6. A class full of 8-year-olds was asked to answer this question. What is a grandparent? I would like to share some of their responses with you. Grandparents are a lady and a man who have no little children of their own. They like to borrow other people's kids. Grandparents don't do anything except be there when we come to see them. They are so old that they shouldn't play or run hard. When they take us for walks, they slow down past things like pretty leaves and caterpillars. Usually, grandmothers are fat, but they're not too fat to tie our shoes. They wear glasses and funny underwear. They can take their teeth and their gums out. When they read to us, they don't skip pages. They don't mind if we ask for the same story over and over again. Everybody should try to have a grandmother, especially if you don't have the internet, because they are the only grown-ups who like to spend any time with us. They know that we need a snack before bedtime, and they say prayers with us, and they kiss us even when we've been bad. And finally, a six-year-old was asked where his grandma lived. Oh, he said, she lives at the airport. And when we want her, we just go get her. Then, when we're done having her visit, we just take her back to the airport. Our grandparent. And again, when I say grandparent, it is inclusive of all of the folks we mentioned a moment ago. They have the warmth of a parent, the wisdom of the sages, and the loving, open heart of a child. Now, family dynamics have changed greatly over the generations. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, only 47%, less than half of American households, are two-parent families. 35% of American children are being raised by single parents. That's more than one-third of our families. And 7% of all American families have, with a child 18 or under, are being maintained by the grandparents. That's 2.4 million families where grandparents have one or more grandchildren living with them. That's an increase of 19% over the last 25 years. So grandparents today carry a much greater responsibility to fill in the gaps in the lives of their grandchildren. When both parents work, it is often the grandparents who spend the most time caring for their children, especially during their formative years. I came from one of those families. As a young child, I was raised in a four-generation household. My sisters, my parents, my grandmother, and my great-grandparents, all of us lived together in one big and very noisy household. It was wonderful, and some of my most cherished family memories happened during those years. But then my great-grandparents died, my parents divorced. My mother could work full-time and raise six children, so it was my grandmother who stepped in and filled that role. Although she also worked full-time, Grandma became our parent. She raised six girls, she shopped and cooked, she taught us how to do housework, she helped us with our homework, she drove us places, made sure we had everything that we needed. She kept us connected to our extended family, and she was the anchor that held us together. But most importantly, she loved us. She listened to us. She dried our tears. She shared her wisdom. And the thing that I am the most grateful for, she was determined with every ounce of her German stubbornness that her granddaughters would grow up going to church, knowing the love of God, and the salvation of Jesus Christ. I credit my grandmother with the faith that I have today, because it was she who started me on my faith journey where I met Jesus. Psalm 71, verses 17 through 18, is sometimes referred to as the grandparents' prayer. It says, O God, you have helped me from my earliest childhood, and I have constantly testified to others of the wonderful things you do. And now that I am old and gray, don't forsake me. Give me time to tell this new generation and their children too about all your mighty miracles. The psalmist here is testifying to God's goodness, how God has been with him ever since he was a child. Now he's praying that God will grant his desire to stay strong and to live long enough to teach younger generations about all of the wonderful things that God has done in his life. This is what God is calling all of us to do. Not long ago, I read something that really grabbed my attention, and it was this. Christianity is only one or two generations away from extinction. I thought, what? But it's true. Christianity is only one or two generations away from extinction. Scripture is full of stories of people and nations who fell away from God because the elders in their societies did not pass on the faith to younger generations. In the Old Testament book of Judges, we read of such a time. The Israelites had wandered through the wilderness for 40 years and finally made it to the Promised Land. Joshua, who was leading the people into this new land, as long as he was alive, they believed in and served the Lord. But at the age of 110, Joshua died. Scripture says that when Joshua's entire generation died off, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. The people did evil in the eyes of the Lord and began worshiping idols. They provoked God's anger, and although he did not abandon them, he allowed them to be defeated by their enemies. God calls parents, grandparents, and other elders to instill belief in God and faith in Jesus Christ into the next generation. We cannot allow our children and grandchildren to grow